it's me, Lynzee Loveridge from Anime News Network, and joining me today is, oh my god, I'm live behind me.
What is happening?
I'm out.
Hey, everybody!
Oh my god. It's the anti-universe. We're already here.
It would not be an A&A stream. If I did not...
That is hilarious.
This is the first time I've ever been in control of, like, the tech side of it, guys. So, like, of course. Let's just hope that's, like, the one thing, and everything else is going to go really smoothly.
Yeah.
So, okay, as I was saying, my name is Lynzee Loveridge. I'm the executive editor of Anime News Network, and joining me today is our social media manager slash video producer, Jacki Jing. And James Beckett, our reviewer extraordinaire. You may remember him from our Attack on Titan reviews, and I got him back again for a very special stream where we are going to try and decipher all of Evangelion, but mostly the last movie. But you can't really get into that without getting into
all of it.
All of it, from start to finish. So, just like a quick overview, this is we're talking about the final film from the tetralogy. Is that what you call it? We had some debate yesterday about films when there's four of them as opposed to three. So it's not a trilogy, tetralogy.
No, tetralogy, 100.
Yeah. Yeah. Not that have the quadrilogy, but I think they maybe just made that up for the box set.
Yeah, and not that I would have known that, but it's just because there have been so many articles and they said tetralogy in it, so I was like, a tetralogy. One of those. But yeah, I really didn't know before I read it in those articles, but yeah.
So these films, it's taken nearly a decade for all of them to come out, if not over a decade.
14 years?
14 years, closer to two decades.
Wow.
To get all of the rebuild of Evangelion films out. And then if you include End of Eva and the original TV series, this is a franchise that's spanned over 25 years. So, and is highly formative to anime as a whole. Like, you can't really talk about anime without talking about Evangelion. I feel like the only thing you can put up there with it, but the same amount of importance is maybe Akira. Like, there aren't a whole lot of, and maybe the Ghost in the Shell movie, right? Like, yeah, you look at those ones, that's kind of about the same significance for the medium as a whole. So the final film, it dropped on Amazon last weekend. So it's been up for about a week. If you haven't got a chance to check it out, you should do that now, because we're going to spoil the entire goddamn thing. Like, we can't avoid spoilers and talk about the end of this franchise, how important it's been, and also try to decipher, you know, what happened to each of the characters, what's their ending point, what does it mean, which may just be, in the end, very highly personal. I feel like what Eva means to you is going to be very personal. James wrote a great editorial that we have up on ANN right now about growing up with the series. So I think to get started, we can each talk about our first introductions to Eva. When did you first see it? What you thought of it initially before we start really breaking down the film. Jacki, why don't you go first?
Oh, I was hoping you wouldn't do that. I was just thinking, I was like, man, I'm gonna get super emotional here. So my brother and I were obsessed with anime and video games. I'm like, have been super candid about that, on our podcasts and, you know, super candid about it on social media. I do have a tattoo that's a sea space cowboy. And it was very tough and it pays homage to my brother, but for a long time I was like, man, should I have gotten the nerve symbol? You know, cause like, these were the two anime that really shaped us as human beings and had such a profound impact on our lives. And I'll be honest, Ian loved Cowboy Bebop more than Neon Genesis Evangelion. And I kind of like Neon Genesis Evangelion more than I like Cowboy Bebop. But like, since my tattoo paid homage to him, I was like, okay, I'm going to get it. And I still want to get a ton of Evangelion tattoos and Naruto tattoos and Attack on Titan tattoos, but like, cost money and time. But anyways, I digress. So, I remember like vividly, like my brother bought like the box set and it was like beautiful. It was like all black, and then just had like the red nerve symbol on it. And I was just like, this box set just looks dope. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I still have that box set to this day. It's in another room. I wish I could show it to everybody, but it's like worn to pieces now, because I've just watched this show so many times over and over again. And it's funny because when we first watched it, I was like, as everybody who watches any Anime News Network stuff, I was like, holy crap, it was gory, and there was robots, and there were like tons of like cool things exploding and aliens. And so like when I was like 16 when we watched it, I was like, that was the dopest anime I ever saw, because it was just like violent and ridiculous and over the top. Yeah. I actually can confidently say that episodes 25 and 26, I was confused. I wasn't mad about it, but I was just straight up like, oh, okay. Well, we were like, you know, blowing up giant angels, and now like everybody's just saying congratulations. I don't know what's happening. But I remember like I rewatched it in my like early 20s, and it suddenly just hit different, you know what I mean? And like I don't know if this has ever happened to y'all, but like I'll reread books like years later, or I'll rewatch a series years later, and I always find it affecting me differently. But I remember when I was watching it in my 20s, and it was just about Shinji and how much he tied his identity to piloting the Ava, and how much he tied his identity to like what like people's approval, and like making sure people liked him, and he was like so caught up with what everyone thought, you know. And in the end, when, you know, he's whining the whole time, he's screaming and crying, he's like, why do people accept me, why doesn't my dad love me, like I don't understand, you know. And I'm just, and you know, we all love and hate Shinji, right? But I was like, man, I've been there. And then when it started to like click, you know, and then he was like, whoa, wait, like my identity doesn't have to be tied to these things, and I can create my own identity, and I can be my own person, and like what people think of me doesn't matter. It's like what I think of myself. And it's like, I was bawling like a little baby. And to this day, whenever I watch episodes 25 and 26, like I get extremely emotional. I cry my eyes out. So for me, I feel like you asked for my introduction to Neon Genesis Evangelion. And, for me, it was like, I had my first intro when I was in my teens, and it was very like fun and, you know, gory and over the top and violent. But then it was actually like, I think when I watched it in my early 20s, when I was like, I felt like I actually was introduced to it. Cause I feel like then I was like, wow, this was a lot more than that. And I'm sure we'll dive into it later. But what I've also loved about this series is what happened on screen, but what happened off screen, you know, because as we know, like Hideaki Anno got a bunch of flack for episodes 25 and 26. And so then he came out with End of Evangelion to be like to the people. And it's just kind of like, it's kind of funny to me, because it's just like, it is turned into a story that has just gone way beyond the story. You know what I mean? And so I think that's why for me, it's just been a series that has stood out so much. Cause it's just like, it's had such a profound impact on me. I know I like, from what I've read and what I've like understood, this series is like legendary in Japan. Like it's like, I'm trying to think of something that's comparable over here. You know,
it's like their Star Wars, basically.
It's like their Star Wars. That's a great way to put it. Yeah. It's like, if you haven't seen it, people are kind of like, well, why? You know what I mean? And so like, I hope someday it can get like that here in the Western world, because it definitely shaped who I am as a person. And I don't think I would be where I'm at if it wasn't for that anime. And I actually have a wall scroll of it. I don't know if we can see it. It's right there in the corner.
Oh, hey.
Hey.
I recognize that key art. Yeah.
Yeah. Right next to a Sailor Moon wall scroll.
Yeah.
So. Anyway,
we go together.
But
Misato and Sailor Moon are voiced by the same person.
You know what? I read something that Hideaki Anno actually, he wanted Misato to be like a older Sailor Moon.
Yeah.
Like that's how he envisioned her. Like, just, which is funny to me, because like, I mean, I love Sailor Moon and I love Misato, but okay, anyway.
You can kind of see the character connection. James, yeah. I know you talked about it in your essay, but for the people who haven't read it yet, do you want to give a quick intro? What was your intro to Ava?
Yeah, I was a 14-year-old kid. I'd been into anime, you know, for as long as I'd been into TV, right? I had Pokemon, Digimon, Dragon Ball Z, Sailor Moon, Rurouni Kenshin, and all that. But Evangelion, I don't really recall because I know it aired on Cartoon Network or Toonami. I think briefly, I don't think they finished the run because I think Cartoon Network realized what the show was. And they're like, oh no, this is not going to appeal.
Dark.
Yeah.
But I was shopping in Best Buy for a DVD to bring on vacation with my folks. And I'd seen it's the Platinum Collection of Evangelion. This is the shiny silver box set with Rey on one side and Asuka on the other. And I'll be honest, at the time, my thoughts were fairly limited to, that's a cool looking title, and those are some pretty hot anime girls, and I like those. So
love it.
I got the DVDs, and I binged the entire series over the course of like 2 days. And I mean, like pretty much everything Jacki was saying about how formative and inspirational and important it was at that time in her life can kind of apply to me. It was probably the first time, you know, speaking of like the way that Anno injected his experiences, not only with like the real world issues of like his the production of the show and the fans. It's the first time I can recall like realizing that an artist could like tear apart their own thing and put it back together. And I guess metafiction, basically, it was like the first time I'd ever been exposed to like the creative process through the creative work itself. And that was just so cool to me. The way that, you know, you showed in the screen cap earlier, the way that it would show like the storyboards and the animatics and the way that it really confronted itself as like, you know, a work of art. And granted, I was 14. So at the time, I probably would have articulated that as, whoa, that was like really weird.
Yeah. But, like that.
Just yeah. A little bit. my hair never got that bowl cut, but.
Aw, cute.
And then the end of Evangelion just blew my mind. It was kind of instantly my favorite thing I'd ever seen in my entire life.
Yeah.
And it's kind of held the top spot as my favorite movie for the past almost 20 years, like past 15 years. And it's just, it really spoke to a lot of the things that I was going through as a kid. I mean, I think a lot of people had that. And then it also inspired me a lot just as a writer and as someone that wanted to make art, because it showed me ways that you could be artistic and be creative beyond just, you know, telling a story. And that was just completely paradigm shifting, world altering to me at 14.
Yeah. So I was about the same age when I first saw it, although it was a slightly different year because I'm slightly older than James. But I was about 14. And the first time I saw the TV series, I know I was in seventh grade, like way too young to be watching this, but that's like my entire experience with media in general. So I was in like seventh grade, and another girl in my dance class was an anime fan, and she had tapes. I think not the entire series. So initially I only saw like the first 2 to 4 episodes, and I had seen like the first 2 to 4 episodes or the tape that's right before Asuka shows up. And mm-hmm. So I like read stuff about it online, and I knew I was going to like her just like based on like the description of personality. She was 100% like my type of anime girl. So I bought the tape where she shows up. That's the only part of the series that like I owned. And I would just watch the Asuka episode over and over again. And it wouldn't be until maybe a couple years later. So that was actually, I was probably more like 13. And that would be a couple years later before I found someone who had the rest of the series on tape. And it was a mix of the dub with the original dub and subtitled. So I like watched it in a mishmash because that was just what they had like recorded and stuff. And that's how I initially saw the whole series and eventually end of Ava. But echoing a lot of what Jacki and James said, my experience with this, what like enticed me about the series was how it was unlike anything else I'd ever watched. Like I was aware of other giant robot shows, like Gundam Wing was probably on Toonami around the time when I finally got to complete the series and stuff. So, like, I knew of other giant robot shows, but I hadn't seen anything animated that was had so much introspection, and like the characters had such like deep internal lives, you know, that wasn't something I'd watched before, where they were like, yes, this person, you know, has insecurities about this, and this is like their backstory and why they're screwed up and stuff. And that just like didn't exist outside of, you know, live action movies and things like that. So that really, and the characters were my age. So that like really drew me to them at the time. I was, you know, especially Asuka. Like, I might relate more to Misato now because I'm her age at this point, but when I was watching it, it was definitely Asuka. Like, she was the person because I was very like, Jacki and I say this a lot in the after show, but like Aries oriented. I have to be the best at everything. I want to be acknowledged for my achievements. I want to be better than the guy next to me. And even though I'm a girl, I'm going to beat him at it and all those other sorts of things. So like, I deeply related to those.
Lynzee and I do not have Ray energy, to say the least.
No. And I'll admit, when I first watched it, I didn't like Ray at all. Like, I had like a chip on my shoulder against like passive, meek characters. But the interesting thing about Ava, and we'll talk about it more when we get into the characters, is how they flip that. You know, they take the prototypical like waifu, meek, subservient girl, and they're like, yeah, actually she hates that. And also, you know, screw you for pigeonholing her in that way, and the, you know, things like that. So anyway, it played with a lot of my expectations just based on the limited anime I'd already seen at that time. And it got me to realize that characters could be like these really deep, complicated people. They didn't just have to be these like cookie cutter archetypes. So that was my intro to Ava. But
Lynzee, just to piggyback of something you
said, yeah, sure.
Like, I love how you said that it was one of the first shows where you saw depth like that, because like, gosh, when I had, you know, I think I was probably like 16 or something like that when I watched it. And I just remember watching like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Sailor Moon, and like, don't get me wrong, like, love those the way that they are, but it was like, they had very little flaws, you know what I mean? And it was like, we never heard about trauma, like, never, ever. Like you said, maybe if, you know, we got a hold of Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind somehow, you know what I mean? But it was
I saw Requiem for a Dream, like, way too young.
Oh, my God!
I saw that around the same time I saw Ava.
Oh, my God. You
kept me off drugs, okay?
Yeah. Well, for sure, yeah. But it was like, I think what was so intriguing to me too was that I was like, whoa, like, other people have trauma, other people are dealing with insecurities, other people like have issues with their parents, like, and so like, I do think that's what made this series so special, was that it did not care about touching on topics that made people uncomfortable.
Right.
And I think that we've seen a lot of people try to do that following up. And, you know, I think we've seen a lot of mediums, like, you know, they do make things uncomfortable, but this was definitely landmark for its time. And when you said that, like, you know, it's on the level of Akira, like, I 100% agree. But even like Akira was like visually stunning and just like jarring. But like, this one was just so, so deep and just like made you confront like pain and insecurity in yourself. At least it did for me. You know what I mean? And it's like, to this day, I can't really think of many other stories that have made me do that. And like, I think that is like, when you said like, that's what made it stick out to you as a kid, like, low key, it is a very disturbing anime, but I also feel like it is a shame if young people have not seen it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it's like, oh man, I mean, like, I still rewatch it to this day, and I still find something new about it. But anyway, that's all I wanted to touch on. We got a long list of stuff to go through, though. So
I also wanted to throw out that we'll probably also be discussing Hideaki Anno to a degree. I watched two different documentary things just about him in preparation for this. Really interesting guy. I do feel like this franchise as a whole is very reflective of his personal experiences, and I'll try to you know, interject with anything about that as we go. James, why don't you give us a really brief
brief
description of the premise of
Evangelion. She did not ask you to do that.
Okay. Oh, that's actually easy. I can do that. Okay. I can do that. That's easy. That's
Let's
fine.
Let's hear it. I that's want to fine. Hear it.
Okay. All right. So, in the year. Oh, God. Okay. I'm already screwing it up. I'm trying to remember if the rebuild movies reset the timeline. In the near future. Yes.
That's good.
In the near future, after an apocalyptic event known as Second Impact has turned most of the world into ruins, the remnants of humanity are kind of fighting to survive. And in Japan specifically, you have this organization called NERVE, or NERV, depending on which
NERV
version.
NERV. Yeah. Gosh, yeah. The Netflix dub killed me. I was like, NERV? Anyways, continue.
NERV has basically the inside scoop on these magical alien creatures that are basically an existential threat to humanity, and the only way to fight them, these angels as they're called, is with the Evangelion robots and
they're organic robots, so
yeah, like, that's a good
they're robot. I think
Anna even said once that they're robots.
There's like a computer system like injected into them, but like they are fleshy and such.
Yeah. And move very lifelike. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
The only people that can pilot these Evangelion robots for complicated lore reasons are young children on the age of 14. Mm-hmm. And Shinji Ikari is one such child. His father, Gendo, is in fact the leader of NERVE. And Gendo calls him back to Tokyo 3, the kind of new, fancy, rebuilt Tokyo. And he says, I need you to come pilot the Evangelion in order to fight the angels and protect humanity. And Shinji and Gendo have what we can charitably call a complicated relationship.
It's the nicest way to ever refer to it.
That is a very nice way to
charitable,
put it.
Yeah, very charitable.
Yeah, and so because of that complicated relationship, there's a lot of hemming and hawing and back and forth. But long story short, Shinji decides to pilot the Evangelion. Unit 1 is his unit, the purple one. He moves in with a boisterous and hard-drinking, I think, Jacki, the term you used was a bad bitch, named Misato, who is kind of his mother figure. And he meets other pilots of the Evangelion units.
I was like, if Misato kisses Shinji, I will throw this monitor. I'm going to throw the monitor across the room because that pissed me off so much. But we'll get into that later. Yeah, I hate End of Evangelion, and I know some people might come at me for that. We'll discuss that later. But yes, okay, sorry. Continue.
No, I mean, there's Misato. It's worth noting. I mean, that's worth pointing out because even though Misato is his mother figure, he definitely kind of has like a crush on her because she's like this really hot, powerful, strong-willed woman. He meets Asuka Langley Soryu, or in the reboot film, she's known as Asuka Langley Shikanami, who is a
There's a reason for that?
Yeah. But she's a half-German pilot who is incredibly hard-headed, stubborn, prideful. She and Shinji have like the most combative relationship. there's Rei, who is kind of the meek, submissive.
Water sign? No, I'm kidding. Just kidding. I'll be quiet.
She's also, I mean, we're in spoilers, right? We can just talk spoilers.
Yeah,
go dive in.
She's also a clone of his mom that he gropes on multiple occasions, so that's fine.
Yeah.
that happens, and that's fine. And they fight a bunch of angels, a bunch of stuff happens, and up until now, I've actually been describing the rough basic premise of both the original TV show and the first rebuild of Evangelion movie.
Right.
But as the angel fights get more and more weird and bizarre and psychedelic and introspective, as Shinji's relationships with the women in his life and the one main guy in his life, his dad, become increasingly fraught and messed up and kind of toxic, that all culminates in both a metaphorical kind of end of the world scenario for Shinji, and also a very literal end of the world scenario where, you know, he's got to pilot the robot to prevent the apocalypse There's also, a lot of question marks in there.
We've forgotten a very important character, James, oh, and I know the audience won't let you go if you don't at least mention Kaoru.
Okay, and then there's Kaoru, who is Shinji's very close platonic friend, who values his close platonic friendship very much. And is
maybe he checked his dick out in the shower.
Maybe. And that's fine. That's what friends do.
Okay, first of all, one of our talking points, Lynzee, we have to discuss sex, like, at some point. Because it's, like, it's funny because in the series and in End Evangelion, it was just, like, randomly thrown in there. And then in the tetralogy, it was, like, he just was, like, we're just going to take that all out and pretend it didn't happen. Which I really want to get y'all's feedback on that. So
wait, you said sex, though?
Like, sexual stuff. Like, it was, like, the tetralogy had zilch.
Well,
like, well, I mean, it had a lot of... It was horny as hell.
Well, but there was no groping. There was no, like, awkward moments. There was no kissing a passed out person. There was no, you know, Misato kissing shit. Like, so I was, like... We'll discuss it later, but it was just interesting to me that that was so prevalent in the series and in the movie, and then we just were like, let's not do that anymore.
I almost grabbed a screen cap of that one shot from that one scene of End of Eva, but then I felt really weird sending that to you guys, and so I didn't.
wait, which one?
Yeah,
What did Amanda Wynn Lee call it in the commentary? The handful of baby batter scene?
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. You're so fucked up.
So bad.
Yeah, we don't need to show everyone the anime.
No, we're good on that.
So, James has just described, like, the general overview of the TV series, and I think maybe we should talk about the TV series ending a little bit, because you need to have some of that context going into the fourth film, I feel like, to really get it, so to speak, because there's visual, the 4.0 plus, or 3.0 plus 1.0, which it's probably called that to avoid calling it 4.0, because 4 is an unlucky number in Japanese anyway, because it's a homonym for death. I actually guess he didn't lean into that, but regardless.
Yeah, that would have been dope. But okay.
Well, they already have death parentheses true squared, so
that's true, they already have that. And that's actually, I've never watched that, just because it's,
but you know what, this was ended so hopeful, maybe he didn't want it to be like
four. That's true, so that might have been intentional on his part as well. Already getting too hot. So for the ending of the we're going to talk about the ending of the television series, so that we have some of the visual context and as well as some of the thematic context that will end up being relevant for the actual final film. And we'll do the same thing for End of Eva as well. So, so the thing about the end of the television series is that we have all of this build up to, like, the final confrontation with the angels. I'm not gonna get immediately into, like, all the weird lore backbiting, because I don't think it's necessary, at least not at this point. We'll have plenty of time for that. But we have all the buildup, and this is possibly why the reaction was initially poor when it aired on TV, and then it immediately goes entirely introspective. So we don't see any of the, like, visual parts of the third impact. We just get, like, an overlay screen that tells us that it happened, and then it's like, now we're going to go inside all the characters' heads for two episodes, and it's entirely Shinji and to some extent Asuka and Misato and Rei sort of confronting their weaknesses and insecurities. And for Shinji, that means, you know, dealing with the hedgehog dilemma, which is prominent throughout the entire series. And it's the idea that you can't have relationships with people without hurting them. Just like if you put two hedgehogs together, if they try to get close for warmth, their spikes inevitably, you know, stick into one another and they hurt one another. So anyway, the idea is that Shinji is always running away from that inevitable pain of connecting with others, so that he doesn't hurt them and to prevent them from hurting him, because he's experienced a lot of that kind of pain from his asshole dad. And mostly just his asshole dad. So, yeah. You know, Gendo is a horrible, horrible father throughout the whole thing. Shows a lot of favoritism towards Rey, which we come to find out has more to do with probably her being, he seeing her as an extension of his dead wife.
Yeah.
Which
for sure.
For sure. So, and so Shinji feels like he can't measure up to that. But in the last two
we episodes, need to have Gendo as a talking point for sure.
Oh, we will definitely.
Yeah, I'm like, there just needs to be Gendo. Yeah.
He gets his moment in the last film.
He does, yeah.
Finally. I mean, I was okay with what happened to him in Deveva, but I also like the resolution in this film for a different reason. But so yeah, Shinji goes introspective. The animation totally breaks down into this sort of like you're looking at storyboards instead of actual fluid animation, and you're looking at sketches. I showed some of those earlier, but let me pull this one up again so we can just, or this is a new one actually, but we just yeah. So things start looking like this, and there's always been talk that, oh, this was a financial compromise. Like, it looked this way because they ran out of money for the television show and, you know, production deadlines and all these other sorts of things. And that's why we got the last two episodes. I'm actually looking at the new film now. It made me rethink whether that's even true or not. Or if Anno is just embracing it. For what it was at the time, I don't know. But even though the animation breaks down in this way, all of the characters, you know, they reflect and they actually find self-actualization at the end of the television series. And Shinji gets his congratulations. You know, you see it memed all the time, but everyone claps for him because it's a hopeful ending. It looked this way, and it didn't deliver maybe the visuals that people at the time wanted.
I loved it.
But it gave the characters catharsis at the end.
Yeah.
Like, and there's a theme in general, and Anno mentions this in the NHK documentary for the latest film as well, but the theme for Evangelion is very much, I mean, there's all the lore and all the, you know, technical parts, but it's an emotional journey first and foremost about Anno and his own depression, and these characters kind of represent an extension of that and how he processed that. So for him, I feel like the end of the TV series was him giving these characters hope, and he got extremely negative reactions to it. People went on message boards and they were so angry. They were talking about how they were going to kill Anno and ways to do it. He found those messages, and he mentions again in the NHK documentary that it completely sapped him of any kind of motivation to create anymore. And he did go on to have two specific suicide attempts where he considered suicide, but then didn't follow through after the TV series was completed. So, and I feel like that's less because people didn't, because of how the series looked, and more because I think he felt betrayed by, or just like he had let his audience down because they didn't understand what he was trying to say. And it seems like it's very important to him, if you watch that NHK documentary, that he feels understood. He never like outright says that. But there's one point where he's in a meeting and he's gotten feedback for the latest film, and people are, and some of the feedback from the staff is that they don't get it. And I swear to God, it looks like he's like on the verge of tears a little bit because they haven't understood him. And it's kind of a repeat of how he didn't feel understood at the end of the television series. So for him, I think it was very, very important to him that people understood that this film and the latest film and this TV series was about the journey of going through depression. So, so this TV series ends, people don't get it. They're angry at him. They're talking about wanting to kill him or how to do it. You know, they're just joking, but I mean, when you're the subject, it's never funny, but they're joking about it on message boards and whatnot. So Anno makes End of Eva. And hey, so Jacki James, which one of you wants to describe what happens in the end of Evangelion film?
Not me. I hate it.
I will literally talk about the end of Evangelion for hours, but I won't because that would not be good. But
thank you.
So it's, I guess it's important to note that within the even though the final episodes of the show kind of really heavily prioritize the emotional journeys of the characters, within the lore of the story itself, it's not really communicated in the show version very well at all. But what the movie version essentially sets out to clarify is that the reason that these characters are going through these...
Why is that doing that? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
The reason the characters are going through these sort of introspective existential journeys in this kind of psychedelic surreal mindscape is because the organization that is behind NERV, has funded NERV, Sele, has been secretly engineering what they call the Human Instrumentality Project. And the goal of Human Instrumentality, in a nutshell, is to force human evolution to the next stage of physical and conscious being. And that by nature entails the dissolution of the barriers between the human soul. And so what you get experientially is all of these people's minds and memories and hearts are kind of smashing up against each other. And so that's why you have in the final two episodes, the characters kind of reliving some of their most traumatic memories and trying to basically process their trauma and not only process it for themselves, but in a way kind of understand the trauma of other people that they're starting to experience. Mm-hmm. That doesn't really come through in the plot of the final two episodes. You get the emotions of it, but the plot doesn't really explain much of that at all. And so what the end of Evangelion does is, and you will get arguments, I've been scouring fan forums and wikis and people still do not agree whether or not the end of Evangelion is basically the real world side of the cerebral story that we got in the final two episodes.
That's what I thought, yeah.
And that's how I've always interpreted it.
Yeah, that's how I did, yeah.
People have argued that there are certain elements of it that are kind of fundamentally incompatible. And so it's...
Also valid, yeah.
It's so for them, it's more of just a strict alternate ending. But either way...
I know. I thought they had to be... somewhat parallel, but you know, they kind of both did their own thing. Before James deep dives in this, I did want to ask you guys, what were your impressions of 25 and 26? Cause I said, when I was younger, it went over my head, but when I watched it in my 20s, I thought it was one of the most beautiful things I had ever seen. You know what I mean? It was taking the animation to that base format was them being taken literally physically and mentally to that base format, you know? And I looking back now, I think it's an absolute masterpiece, work of art, you know? So it's I just wanted to see what y'all thought of it. You know, James is a fan of End of Evangelion, but for me, it's God, 25 and 26 is, it's just to me a masterpiece. And it's funny because the people who got mad, were probably teenagers that were of the same mindset that I had been, you know, who were mecha, blood, gore, where is that? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's just funny because I remember when I watched it when I was a teen, it went over my head, but I remember being intrigued, but I had really bad ADD and I still do. So at the time I was that was weird. Okay. You know? Yeah. But then it was when I watched it for the second time and had frankly real life experiences and maybe had in ways realized that I was dealing with insecurity and trauma, a little bit more than I had when I was a teenager, you know, mm-hmm. I was just this guy's a genius. You know what I mean? So anyway,
I watched the original two as a teenager, it was definitely, I was very into weird art kind of already at the time. That doesn't mean I understood it. I definitely didn't understand the full breadth of it, but I did kind of appreciate how weird it was, just even for just the sake of being weird.
Yeah.
But I rewatched the entire television series when it dropped on Netflix, which I guess now was about 2 years ago. Right.
Gosh, don't say that. Nuts.
Don't say that.
You're right. Cause it dropped right during the beginning of Oh, I can't believe it's been 2 years.
Yeah. Anyway, when the entire TV series and the end of Ava film dropped on Netflix, I rewatched it all and definitely was more appreciative of the final two episodes as an adult and having again, Jack said, experienced more, had more self-awareness for my own emotions and experiences and felt it was way more relatable at that point.
Yeah, I don't recall. It's funny. I have such vivid memories of like my first viewing of Eva, but it's so like tied because it did not take me long to find the end of Eva and to watch it. I think it was within a couple of weeks of finishing the show because they still sold the manga UK box the double pack. And so I think at the time I was vaguely aware that there was more Evangelion. Mm-hmm. Like I'd seen the manga box. And mm-hmm. so like I knew that there was more stuff. And so I don't think I was hit in the same way that maybe like the original audience was that, what, this is it? That's all there is?
Mm-hmm.
And so I think because of that, I kind of just sort of accepted it as like almost like the second to last chapter of the story. Yeah. And so I definitely wasn't mad or anything. Yeah. And I definitely didn't like, I've never been in the camp where like I have really strong feelings that like one version of the either like the original 25, 26 or the end of Eva are better. I think for me, because I saw them so close together, it's all always been just like one thing.
Together, yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
For me, I didn't see End of Evangelion until years later.
Oh, okay.
And it was because people were like, well, you know, it didn't really end like that. And I was like, what do you mean it didn't end like that? You know what I mean? And then I saw that and then I was like, what is this sacrilege? But okay.
Because the mood of this film is a lot different than the ending of the television series.
Well, it was him, like from what I've read, and Lynzee, you're far more an expert at this than me, but he was retaliating. Like he was like, you guys want the gore, you want the guts, you want things to be like sad and like awful, then like this is what you get. Am I wrong?
No, I mean, he included, let me just...
I know, this is the creepiest.
I mean, so this...
I've had that guy just thumbs up in the camera stuck in my head for like 15
oh
years.
Oh my God,
that guy has just been living in my brain.
Like, what I have heard is that someone I know via Twitter is in this picture somewhere.
Don't
remember who it is. But regardless, so this image, it's in the End of Eva movie, as are some of the death threats that Anno got. I think actually mailed to the Gainax's office. So they were actually like, this wasn't on the internet. They were like physically mailed to him.
I never noticed that guy with the Oscar Gray doll.
To me, this
is like, isn't that the cutest thing ever?
I have I relate to the mood of Anno, I feel like, in this film quite a bit because I too am secretly like a huge retaliatory bitch. So for him to just be like,
yeah, talk shit, get hit.
Yeah. No. So it definitely got that feeling there. So he includes like pictures of the audience that went to see it, the death threats that he got, all that kind of stuff. And so when End of Eva came out, it shows you that. James, did you send me the final shot? Like it shows you, you know, what supposedly happened. Yes, of course you did. James also put really funny captions on all of these pictures that or may not be able to see. So this movie is so full of anger, it feels like to me. Like if you watch 100%. It is just so angry. You know, but there are going to be throwbacks when we get to the next film that relate directly to this, including this particular scene, the one that showed
cry.
Up.
Ray, I'm going
to
cry so hard. It's just not even funny.
Ray's head that I showed earlier. There's a callback to the Ritsuko Gendo confrontation at the very beginning, you know, because in End of Eva, it's either shown or implied that Gendo, you know, shoots Ritsuko and kills her. And then when you get to 3.0 plus 4.0, she just like puts a couple bullets in his head. He's fine because he's really weird in the movie. But
you know, I have a point to make about that scene, by the way. I have a pet theory.
Can you tell it?
But so this movie is so angry and essentially, you know, impact happens. My understanding of it is that Shinji does not completely self-actualize, but, and I feel like this is honestly somewhat a reflection of Anno as well, but it's also consistent with Shinji's personality. Shinji wants to die, but he is afraid of pain. So he can't kill himself. And Ono actually cites that as the reason why he didn't follow through with his attempts either, is because he was scared that it would hurt. Which, yes, it's really sad.
It's really sad.
So Shinji wants to die, but he can't follow through with it. Instrumentality basically happens in the fact that we see all the cast members
turn to tang, as James,
likes to call it, turn into that primordial soup. And get their wish. Rei does subvert Gendo's initial plan, though, because he attempts to, you know, control her in order to become a god with Yue, because he's Gendo. So that does get subverted, but in the end of it, the only two survivors are, at least it's implied, the only two survivors of humanity are Asuka and Shinji. Asuka puts that fight scene in this film with Asuka, where she's
greatest,
like,
of all time.
Greatest of all time. Railing on those like white Evangelion vulture thing. Yeah, like cannot be topped.
So fun.
But anyway, the two of them are left on Earth. Shinji attempts to choke her out. That also kind of mirrors a scene earlier in the film where Asuka is shown to be choking Shinji, but I don't think that actually happened. I think it's a psychological thing about their butting heads or whatever. But anyway, he starts to kill her, but can't follow through with it. And she tells him, the final words of the film are "Kimochi wa Rui," which can be translated, without, you know, considering the full context of everything, quite a few different ways. I've seen it subtitled as "You're disgusting," like she's saying it to him and just, like, you know, diminishing him. I've seen it as "I feel sick," which would definitely make sense given everything that's going on around her at the time. But then the movie just ends. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Ono's basically like, yeah, you got all your action, all your gore and everything. Also, humanity's wiping out. You all suck.
Yeah. Why? That was how I took it. It was like, this movie was a complete F you. And he like made all the characters that we love do stuff that made us hate them. Like, you know, it was just like, I literally hate this movie. Like, I hate it. And I get it.
You hate how it makes you feel.
I hate how it makes me feel. And I hate how it made Hideaki Anno feel. Like, like you said, it's like he made a masterpiece then people like had to beep all over it and piss him off. And then he retaliated with this. And I know that he's come out and said like, they're both endings to it and been very vague about it, you know, but like in my heart of hearts, like, and I think that, like you said, you brought up like exhibit A, exhibit B, it's like he was rage filled when he made this and he was just lashing out. And like, I can understand, like, let's give it some respect that, like Lynzee, like you said, this is a retaliatory mother effer, and he like did this, and that's pretty effing legit, and he made it into a movie, like, you know what I mean, like that's retaliation on a whole nother level. So like let's give him respect for that, you know. And the movie, you know, to me, it's like almost like transcendentalism versus existentialism. Like, you can almost compare them in this way that it's kind of like, it's cool that you have this comparison to it. But to me, it's just such a, I guess you're right. Like, I hate the way it makes me feel, because it's like the first one, the 2526, left me with like hope. And I really did see, like, you know, like a change in myself after that. And then after watching End of Evangelion, it made me sad and discouraged and like unhappy and like didn't leave me in a good place.
It's not,
like,
it's not a hopeful ending. Like, yeah. I don't.
So I want to hear it. I've always argued, and this is kind of one of my like nerd boy hills that I die on, at least for me. Right. Because I think, I don't think you can't argue that the movie is angry and that it is spiteful and that it is filled with a lot of really dark emotions. And so I think it 1,000% makes sense that people walk away from it feeling that. Mm-hmm. But for me, I've always found the End of Evangelion to be a really fundamentally hopeful film.
Oh, okay. I want to hear this.
Yeah, me too.
So, I mean, so a lot of it, so in order to contextualize it, as far as the ending goes, the way that I've always understood it as it's explained in the movie is that at the end, Shinji does self-actualize because he has that conversation with his mother where basically he has the choice to dissolve into the sea of LCL, the sea of Tang. Mm-hmm. Now that all of humanity's souls are splooshed into Tang and no one has any boundaries and there aren't any individuals anymore, What you have instead is this sort of nebulous fantasy dream world. And in the 25 and 26 ending, that's represented with that kind of cutesy slice of life version of Eva, where like Ray's running around with breakfast toast and Shinji and Oscar are like, you know, the childhood friends that are going to date someday.
Yeah.
And
they're going to just go to school and have like a
normal. Yeah.
Yeah.
And in the end of Eva, that's represented more. And it's one of those things that doesn't come across super clearly in the film, but you have all these live action scenes with these kind of adult Japanese women who are living their lives. And the idea is that Shinji for a while is contemplating a world in which he doesn't exist, right?
Right.
He's trying to decide, would the world be better? Would the lives of these women that I love be better if I did not exist? Mm-hmm. And he ends up having that kind of moment with Ray and Kaoru and his mom, where he acknowledges that, you know, for as much as it might be nice to imagine like a fantasy anime world where everything is just happy-go-lucky and has all the cliches, or as tempting as it might be to imagine a world where you can just disappear completely and not even exist anymore, there is a fundamental need to find a way to live in a world where people can hurt you and people can be shitty and people can make you feel like they don't understand you and like they will never understand you, no matter how much you kind of, you know, scream and cry and beg them to, they might not ever get it. But at the very end there, I never read it as that, you know, Shinji and Asuka are the last two survivors of all humanity. I've always interpreted as, because at the very end, Yui has like one or two lines where she says, anyone that wants to come back and to live in this world, this really crappy, difficult, emotionally fraught, scary, depressing world, if they want that, if they're willing to kind of brave that life, they can come back out of the sea. And, you know, Shinji and Oscar are maybe some of the first people to come out. But I've always read the movie basically as Anno. If the first movie was Anno trying to kind of convince himself that he felt okay and that the world was worth living in and being happy in, I feel like the movie is Anno being confronted with a lot of ugliness and a lot of pain and a lot of anguish and basically deciding the same thing, but out of spite, where he says, no, I'm going to figure out who I am. I'm going to figure out a way to live, and I'm going to try to find a way to be understood, even if it is something that causes me pain. And, you know, inevitably, you know, as he discovered when people sent him all those horrible letters, you know, sometimes your best and most genuine and vulnerable attempts to be heard will backfire horribly. But at the end of the film, you know, you have that moment. And I've read, you know, that scene where Shinji is strangling Asuka. I've read, and I even think it might have come up in like one of the translations of the Japanese commentary, but I might be mixing things up. But I've read that the idea is that he's trying to, you know, he's trying to connect with her now that they're both separate individuals. And the last like emotion that he has, you know, the last memory that he has is of that terrible fight that they had, and it's all kind of mixed up in his head. And, you know, it's a violent, kind of disgusting act, just like Asuka says, but it's, you know, she reaches up and kind of has that tender moment where she strokes his face.
Right.
And for me, that was always him realizing that even this, you know, that there can be moments of tenderness even when you feel like everything is literally the end of the world. And yeah, it's a bummer, but I think it's kind of a hopeful bummer, right? It's like the version of nihilism where you say, yeah, the world is chaotic and there's no point and everyone sucks and no one will ever understand you and life is pain. But you know what? You gotta keep pushing forward anyway. And when I was 14 and going through a lot of stuff myself, I think that message for me was kind of valuable in its own way, you know?
Yeah.
That's interesting. I think it's so funny. I think at my prime put my dad, which is kind of how I see it. I'm like, Shinji just F's up everything because he's just being selfish and can't see beyond himself. And then, like, at the end, like, there is, like, Asuka, like, touching his face in a touching moment. But really, it's, like, him being, like, oh, my bad. Like, this is all really bad and I got us here. And so, like, that's a really, like, hopeful way to look at it. But it's just kind of, like, still, like, I'm, like, when you had 25 and 26 and it was just, like, so positive and uplifting. But I guess I could see, like, that they hit such a rock bottom and there's still, like, a little bit of hope. But at that point, I'm just so devastated and tired and sick. Like, I think every, you know, even the people in the film, like, you know, the people watching. And so it's, like, that little bit of hope didn't feel, like, good to me. Like, it was just kind of, like, oh God. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, I guess it was present, but for me, it was just like a not enough to push, to make me feel really good about it. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I can tell for you, you were like, wow, like he can still come back from this and all these people can crawl out of here and all this stuff. But like, for me, I'm like, how did we get here? I'm like, Shinji, like, come on, bro. Like, we didn't have to go this far, but actually you talking about it, it makes me feel like there is something nice about there being a way to be forgiven no matter how far you go, or that there's hope no matter how far you go. Like, that is a really nice thought. I think it's just like, for me, I'm just like, Shinji, like, what did Atma Prime say? It's like, all this has gone wrong. And then he's like, my bad. And I'm like, dude, you know what I mean? So I don't know. I like that you explained your side. And I actually, for someone who absolutely hates that movie, you made me like see the other perspective a lot better now. But it's still like, to me, just, it's a movie that rubs me the wrong way. And I do feel like it's just from a place that was really, really dark, you know? So.
And that's kind of where we were at with the entire franchise until the rebuilds were announced. I think it's worth noting, and because I feel like it's very relevant to some of the stuff that ends up coming up in this film. Anno did other projects after Ava. He was still sort of writing out depression at the time. There was the attempt to do Karikano that famously kind of fell apart at the end. There was a lot of really bad management and stuff going on at Gainax as well, which wasn't Anno's fault, but obviously affected his creative output quite a bit. He wrote a op-ed that got published last year. You can head over to Aiden and read it if you want to get all the dirt on all the horrible stuff that happened to his IPs and things like that, and how Gainax ripped him off after he was both there and after he left as well. So I'm sure that kind of left a bad taste in his mouth. He did a couple live action projects, a little film called Shin Godzilla. That happened during this. Never mind.
The big delay for 3.0 plus 1.0 was because of Shin Godzilla.
It was Shin Godzilla, like, and he also went through another depression spiral. Like, there's a very short little animated film that Studio Kara actually hosts, and it has his wife and him as their character counterparts, because his wife, Miyoko Anno, is a manga artist, and she actually did an entire little manga called Insufficient Direction, which is just about her and Anno being married. And like their relationship and like how geeky he is and how geeky she is and stuff. And his obsession with Kamen Rider and all these other sorts of things. But it talks about them making the movies, and it does say that, like, you know, he got tired, and they show him like actually physically injured, even though he didn't like physically get hurt, but he's, you know, dealing with mental health. So he went to make Shin Godzilla. And he also went and voiced the main character in a Studio Ghibli film, because Hideaki Anno and Hayao Miyazaki go way, way, way back and are really good friends that just don't work together because then they fight, but otherwise are, you know, great.
He's really good in it too. I was really surprised.
Yeah. Hayao Miyazaki described Anno in the NHK documentary as an alien, which I have some thoughts about that too, actually, that maybe we can get into when we talk about him a little more. But as far as in between the end of Ava to 1.0, I'm pretty sure he got married, met Miyoko Anno, and got married in that time span. And you'll see, I think, throughout the rebuild films, how much influence having his wife in his life has been for him. In my personal interpretation, she is in these movies. And I'll talk about that a little bit more too.
Oh my God, yeah. I can't wait to hear about that.
Yeah. So here is, we are finally going to start on 3.0 plus 1.01 thrice upon a time.
We've been talking an hour about the old stuff. We haven't gotten into the new stuff yet, guys.
Like,
you need context. We need context.
I know.
All the context is really important. I'm also really impressed that it doesn't look like we've dropped a bunch of viewers or anything. So you guys are holding out for this. So kudos to you. We're going to talk about this movie. So, James.
Hi.
Hi. I'm not going to make you do 1.0 and 2.0. Those are mostly remakes of the original series with the addition of Mari, who's the new pilot that kind of shows up. She's the one who's got red frame glasses and sometimes puts like cat sound effects into her speech. But 3.0 starts post, it's where the diversion mainly happens, which is in the TV series, Shinji does get like absorbed into his Ava for a while and basically like hibernates. It's I feel like mostly a another like representation of him hiding from the world and not wanting to be hurt. So he like literally just like liquefies into the LCL and is like there and they can't get him out. But in the TV series, I think he's only in there for like a week.
No, he's in there for a while.
Or maybe a few months.
He's in there for a while.
But we find out in 3.0, he's been in there for like 15 years.
Yeah. You know.
Just like, no, I'm done. And he awakens from that. So I was hoping you could maybe kind of talk about 3.0 and then and how that leads into 4.0. We won't talk about 3.0, I promise, because we're going real long. But context for where we're at when 4.0 opens.
Oh man, okay, let's see. I'm puzzling out of my head how to possibly explain this in a way that makes even like a fraction of rational sense. The story of Evangelion 2 diverged in a few key ways that we don't have to get into, but one way that it diverged was that in attempting to rescue Rey from being absorbed by, God, I don't know, the 10th angel? I think the numbers are different. One of the angels, the one with the paper arms.
I know exactly which one you're talking about. The ones that, like,
Rey gets eaten by an angel, and it's also kind of important to know, just for the context of the whole series, that Rey is not only a clone of Shinji's mother, but she's also kind of a clone of Adam, the first angel, which Kaoru also is, which is important because, long story short, if the first angel, Adam, or maybe Adam's, whatever, there's Lilith too. Lilith is either the first or the second. Right. Lilith is a different being. There's Lilith, who is the spawn of humanity, and then there's Adam, who is the spawn of all the angels, the progenitor of the angels, Lilith, progenitor of humanity. If they ever smush, that's how you get an impact.
Right.
That's how you
get an impact. One of the ways you get an impact anyway.
Yeah, there's tons of ways.
Yeah.
Now, if you put your pen cap on the wrong way, then there could be a fifth impact in that world. But
if you wiggle your left toe and look in the wrong direction.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
But that's one of the ways. And Sele wants that to happen at a very specific time in a very specific place, because that's how you turn everyone into Tang and make them into the next stage of human evolution. And Gendo also wants that to happen, but at a slightly different time and in a slightly different context, because that's how I guess he's gonna be able to reunite with the soul of his dead wife.
He basically wants his consciousness to go back and meld with Yui's consciousness, because he's a really sad man and he misses his dead wife.
Yeah.
Essentially.
Yeah.
But all that's important to understand, because Shinji piloting the Evangelion, which is partially made of Adam, it doesn't make sense. But point being, Shinji, Ava, smushes with Rey for a bit, goes berserk, third impact almost happens.
Almost, they're able to stop it.
They call it near third impact, but it really messes up the world real bad.
Shinji gravity is all crazy. Like, what is gravity anymore? Like,
The whole world turns into a level from a Control, that game, the Remedy game. And so and Shinji gets sucked into the ever for 14 years. Meanwhile, a lot of stuff happens that never even gets kind of explained. Mm-hmm. Fast forward 15 years. Shinji gets popped out of his Ava, which also contains the soul of his dead mom. I don't know if I mentioned that, but that's going to be relevant later, maybe.
Yeah, it's important to know that actually, like, all the Evas, at least in the original TV series, had a soul in them. Like, Asuka's Eva had her mother's soul as well, which is what caused her mom to go crazy, because her soul got separated from her, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, this is weird gravity.
So who was Ray's then?
Who's Ray's what?
I think it's just another Ray.
Yeah, they've never. Okay, that makes sense. And the dummy plug system is all Rays.
Kairos.
Also, to my understanding, there were multiple Rays, right? Because she would just die, and he'd just be like, "Oh, let's get another one out there."
They cloned a whole bunch of her. There's no one really knows where, like, the first Ray came from. Or it's kind of implied that, like, they murdered a child at one point. And
then... Oh yeah, she got super strangled by Ritsuko's mom.
Oh my god.
But anyway, more context.
There is so much, like, drama behind the scenes. Like, Gendo effing Ritsuko and his mom, and, like, all of this, like, and just...
Dude, guy's horny as fuck, man. Like, has no emotional connection, but definitely is banging everybody. Like, what's going on? I don't know. I don't know. Trying to fill that empty hole that his wife left.
They took that all out of the movies. Like, there's none of that. There's none of the, like, none of that. Like, there's
or
no,
did they?
I was waiting. I was waiting for Misato to kiss Shinji and me to throw my monitor across the room, because I was like, this is their chance to redeem themselves for that terrible moment that, like, ruined anime for me almost, because I love Misato so much. But anyway, we can talk about that later.
Yeah, we kind of got. You were talking about how,
right.
Anyway, so he pops out of his Eva. Yeah. It's been 15 years. Misato's running, is it pronounced Ville?
Ville.
Ville, which I is think. Sort of like a counter, they're kind of like a counter terrorism group, I guess, if you want to call, like, Sele a terrorist group, because they want to make all of humanity. Yeah. So anyway, they're actively fighting against Gendo and his plans to do that.
There's Avas all over the place. There's just Avas all over the place.
They just really don't want Shinji to get into the robot. Like, no more robots for you. Go hang out with your boyfriend and play the piano for a while. Boyfriend.
It'd be so platonic.
They've introduced these collars, which will just blow up if you don't, you know, do what you're supposed to. Kaoru dies, because he always dies, the poor kid. And it's just, you know, that's one consistency.
Who blew up the collar for him?
Kaoru blew his own collar up.
So he blew himself up. Okay, because I was just like, Okay, that makes sense.
So that happens, which scars Shinji deeply, if he wasn't already scarred enough.
There's another impact in there. There's a fourth impact.
There's a fourth impact in there as well, which he is blamed for, because, you know, he wasn't listening to about not getting in the robot. And that's where 3.0.
Oh, Asuka's still 14, because it turns out that if you're an Evangelion pilot, you stop aging.
She's also a clone.
And also a clone. So, yeah, okay. So, we can talk about that later.
I thought she was 28.
she is, but her body
stayed the same. Okay.
Yeah, so, like, she's, you know, an adult, but she's trapped in this young
body.
That feels definitely like a specific call out to her own insecurity, because Asuka in the TV series, you know, she thought if she was mature enough, she could grow up, she could date Kaji, you know, she's a woman, she wants to be seen in this womanly way.
Yeah.
And it's almost kind of like painfully mocking, where they're like, okay, now you're, you know, you've lived to be 28 years old, but your body doesn't grow anymore.
Yeah.
But she's got this interest in Kensuke, and he's like, you look like you're 14, I just cannot.
Ken-Ken. Wasn't it so great to see them? And they're all grown up. Also, so they made, so they had Asuka pilot Eva 3 instead of, what was his friend's name, who is now a doctor?
Toji.
So because Toji in the series, he had piloted 3, right? Remember? And then it was like all like crazy. So I don't know. I thought that was an interesting mix up. And then her clone apparently died in that, right? Or did she survive and her eye was... I don't know.
Oh yeah, James, what's going on with her eye? Please. I'm actually really confused about how they put, like, a fucking angel in her eyeball.
Yeah, like, it was basically when she activated it, it, like, Right? That was a good description of what happened, huh?
I think that is one of the many instances of this entire franchise, Thrice Upon a Time especially, wherein it's just go with it. It's cool. It's a thing that happens.
Yeah.
I think what happened is Hideaki Anno or someone on the creative team pitched the idea that, hey, we've had her with this eye patch for the last two movies. She should like yank a monster out of her eye. And Anno was like, I like that. Let's give it a name.
I'm okay with it too.
And it'll happen. Yeah.
It was dope. It was really dope.
Yeah. So the way I understood it, and I've only seen the movie all the way through once, you have those, and I forget what they're called, and everyone in the chat, I hope you can forgive me for forgetting the frankly unconscionable amount of proper nouns that that movie throws at us.
Yeah.
But you have those pillars that Vile created. Mm-hmm. So basically, ward off the zombie Ava unit things, and it's basically like a way to stave off the angels. It's like anti-angel. It's like an anti-angel beacon. Yeah. I thought that thing in her eye was basically like an anti-angel implant that they were keeping in her.
That's what Nick is saying here too. As well. Yeah. Look at the comment below. So it's so she's got angel like in there in her that she can't And to keep it under control, they've put some of that tech, like James is mentioning, and that you see in the film, to keep the LCL-fication, that's just the word I'm going to use for that, at bay. So I guess we've kind of jumped into finer details without going over the larger details. So the larger detail of 4.0, I'll give you a break for this. Okay, so the larger detail of 4.0 is, right, so Shinji is traumatized from the death of Kaoru, his one true love, if you ask me. But
yes, 100%. Yes.
Their names are in the book of life together, guys. He says that in the movie.
Yeah.
So anyway, he's traumatized from the death of Kaoru. Is basically in a similar state to what you see at the end of Ava, where he is catatonic. He doesn't talk for like the entire first arc of this film. So instead we have
it's like 30 straight minutes. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. No lines, nothing. So we have Shinji, Asuka, and Rei. Mari is not there. She's still on Vile. They are going for a walk to go check out humanity. And there's a village there. And some of their former classmates who have now all grown up live there. And that includes Toji and Hikari. They are now married and they have an adorable baby. And they live with Hikari's dad. You have Kensuke, the military otaku.
I'll never get over that. I will never get over how he became just a cool son of a bitch.
Yeah. I know. How did that happen?
He just like a repairman and stuff. He just kind of goes checks on the border, make sure everything's working how it's supposed to. Asuka appears to be living with him. So when she's not on Vile, she lives with him.
Naked constantly, which is...
Whatever. What are clothes anymore? It's post-apocalypse times four. Who cares? Yeah. So yeah, she's just kind of, you know, mostly nude, playing on some weird Game Gear-esque video game thing most of the time. So the first act of the film I felt was actually mostly centered on Rei. Mm-hmm. So we have one of the Rei clones. She's not the same as the one that was in the first two films because that one has died. She is kind of discovering what it means to be humans. Meanwhile, like Shinji is just like sitting in a corner and doesn't eat or anything. And so
I just say?
Yes,
I read that that Studio Ghibli helped out with this section.
Even be surprised. That's what not happens when you're friends with Hayao Miyazaki. Yeah. You can just call that kind of favor in, right?
But also, Rei discovering her self-actualization through the value of manual labor is the most Miyazaki-ass thing ever seen in my life.
Yes.
I could think the whole movie. I was like, Miyazaki's sitting there somewhere just nodding with like gruff approval.
Yes,
at this whole 100%.
It was very
even the way it looked, though, it looked very like Miyazaki, these parts. Sorry, Lindsay.
No, it's fine. Yeah, it's very much like it's got this pastoral feel to it. You know, like you were saying, the value of hard labor. She, you know, figures out she basically works in a rice field with a bunch of old ladies and then like goes bathing with them and then starts separating herself from her responsibility as a pilot. Like she wears the plug suit for a really long time, but by the end of it, she's put on normal human clothes. And then meanwhile, Shinji tries to become a penguin. He basically goes to these ruins where Tokyo 3 used to be. Pen somehow maybe started a colony there, because there's like more than one penguin. Pen even's got a goddamn family in this movie. So he just is hanging out with them. Asuka is watching over him a little bit, but from a distance. Like, she asks Rei to basically go check on him regularly, make sure that he eats. So Rei brings him food.
She really aggressively crams hardtack down his throat.
He deserved it. He's being, I was just like,
you're, it looked like Calorie Mate, I think. Like, she's just like force feeding him Calorie Mate. And it's and she's really angry with him. And it's sort of the same consistent anger I feel like Asuka has always had towards Shinji that she won't admit is actually reflective of herself. Like, I feel like Asuka feels the same way Shinji does, but the difference is that Asuka doesn't feel like she has the luxury of indulging it at all. And so she gets angry with him for basically reflecting her feelings back at her and not just sucking it up and pulling himself up by his bootstraps, whole sort of deal. But yeah, the first part of this movie is Rei Ayanami just, she asked Shinji to name her, and I'll admit, I was really disappointed that he just named her Ayanami. I was hoping he would give her her own unique sense of identity.
I was hoping that too. I kind of wanted her to pick her name. I wanted her to pick her name, and then when she asked him, I was like, okay, maybe it's because she feels a connection with him, like cute, whatever. But then that pissed me off too. So I'm glad I wasn't alone in that.
Yeah.
Like, sound off in the chat. What should Rei's name have been?
Yeah, that's actually, please. Yeah, if not Rei, what should Rei's name have been? Like, I would have accepted anything. Like, I don't know, Midori or something like that. Because
Anything.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's kind of where the first part ends. But Rei starts to discover, even though she's coming to accept herself as a unique individual, that she, however, cannot live separately from LCL inside the robots because she wasn't made to live the way that she's currently is. And so her inner time is, and she realizes that she's gonna
tang.
So she goes to see Shinji and just, you know, they have a really, really good heart to heart, and then she tangs. And surprisingly, Shinji doesn't have another goddamn meltdown from it.
So did she choose to tang?
It was inevitable. It was like an inevitable, like...
It was an inevitable tang. Dang, that sucks.
Yeah, it does after you spend that much time, like, growing with her and everything.
So then who was long-haired Rei? Who, she looked dope with long hair. I was like, okay, Rei. But
She shows up at the end, and my impression is that is original Rei.
Okay. And it was just
existing,
like,
in the consciousness.
Exactly. Like, it's not like a physical form. It was just like her being. I get it. It's hard to articulate, but yeah. Okay.
So yeah. So I mean, Rei just. I gotta show. I've got screenshots of Shinji and penguins. if anyone wants to see Shinji with the penguins, it's right here. I wish this process was a little like. Yeah, but there's your Shinji with the penguins under the bridge. But yeah, so Rei's death, instead of causing Shinji to go curl up again, it actually causes him to kind of wake up. It's like he appreciates what she was able to discover about herself right before her death. And instead of getting really sad, it kind of motivates him. And so he decides to go back to Ville with Asuka. And they immediately lock him up because they're like, you done fucked up like three times now. You're done. Like, end game. Go to your room. Don't come out until we say so. And then Gendo starts making his game plan. And I'm going to tap out here, James. It's your turn now.
God. Okay. So the short version is that none of it matters. And that's not actually me being facetious. It's right. There's just a whole sea of new Eva units, new magical spear artifacts. Gendo has an alien eyeball face because he took the key of Nebuchadnezzar, which I think is also made of Adam. It never gets explained, but that got shoved into his hand and it turned him into like part angel / god. And so he is able to put himself inside of Unit 13. That's the two pilot unit, I think. Yeah. And Unit 13 goes through the doors of Guff, which he opens because he has started an additional impact, which is more impact than four. And the additional impact, which was his plan all along,
right,
somehow allows him to basically, through a very convoluted and occasionally hard to follow series of action scenes, lure all of Vile on the Wunder to the doors of Guff, which is an interdimensional gateway that will lead him to the anti-universe. No, we don't know what the anti-universe is, and no, it's never been mentioned in the series before, but that is fine.
Yeah, what was this? Like, he was like, I connected with the Nebuchadnezzar or something. I was like, huh?
Here's the thing. I am 99% sure that this whole section of the film is Anno having a laugh at all of our expenses, where he's like, well, actually, I have a whole metafictional theory about why Gendo is doing this and why it gets so absurd. But
we're going to talk about Anno's actual dad at some point, because he relates into this, and he's talked about it. He talks about it in the documentary.
I'm sure he's a great guy. When Asuka angelifies herself by ripping the thingy out of her eye, she gets sucked into the door of Guff as well, which Gendo also planned. They make a point. Mari makes a point to be like, oh, Gendo wanted her to do it, because that gives Shinji a reason to get into the robot so he can rescue his loved ones and finally have a dad talk for the first time in his life. So he goes into the door of Guff with his dad, which takes them into the anti-universe, which is also a place called, which also contains a Golgotha artifact and an imaginary Evangelion, which is not the same thing as Lilith. It is a fictional Evangelion.
It's a theoretical Evangelion. So, like, okay, so... I mean, it is. So
in the dub, he straight up uses the word fiction, which I was like, okay, Gendo.
Yeah. Okay. So the second act, I think I summed it up on Twitter as Ava getting so far up its butt. It's just like, yeah. I'm sure for some people, like, this part of Ava is extremely interesting, and they enjoy, like, dissecting all of the religious references, the apocryphal text references. There's a lot of references to, like, Kabbalah and things like that. The staff have said that they just think it's, like, fun flavor. So I don't know if it's ever really all supposed to, like, make sense. Like, for instance, the gate of Guff that James is talking about is supposedly where souls are made. So if you go in it, that's supposed to be, like, where God creates souls that eventually go into humanity. When they introduced Ava Imaginary, I was just like, I think I sighed really deeply, kind of like that. Like, I know what an imaginary number is, like, technically, like, you know, in math, right? And I was like, maybe it's just like, they talk about it as something that was introduced by Misato's father, who was kind of a son of a bitch scientist who is technically responsible for second impact in some ways. So, and his research is always, like, fed into nerve or whatever. So,
there's a theme of bad fathers here.
There are a lot of themes about bad dads doing bad things in Ava in general. Sometimes it's the bad mom every once in a while. Asuka got the bad mom route. But
I mean, Yui's not the best mom, if you really, like, think about it. Like,
Yui's, like, best ultimate mom somehow. So I have no idea, even with all the context we're about to get into, I still have no idea how her and Gendo, like, ended up together. But
I know.
But
well, you know what? She had some father issues, possibly, and she saw her father in him and somehow wanted to win the love of her father through Gendo. I'm totally making this up, but that's plausible explanation for her being with him. But
yeah, as James was saying, like, Act Two gets really, really into, like, all the weird terminology about how to make new impacts, why this impact happened, like, the current impact that's about to happen is happening where the second impact happened, because they, you know, just that was in Antarctica, right?
Yeah, they need the black egg of Lilith, which is the anti-moon that got embedded into the crust of the Earth when the regular moon got made.
Makes sense.
Which is just, you know, how things happen. Yeah. So, like, there's all these sort of, like, mystical objects that kind of get thrown into the second act here. I'm sure if we made like a giant list of all the term dropping and then cross-reference, I did this once for an article on A&N, and it was just about the history of all the angel names that are dropped in the original series.
Oh, wow.
And it took a long time because some of those names are from, like, we're not just talking about like Michael or Raphael or Uriel or anything like that. Like, the really obscure references. I was like, who looked this up in Japanese? Because it's hard enough to find it in English. Like, some of it, you know, came from like weird occult stuff that was published in like the 1800s or whatever. Anyway.
It's literally that scene from when, what's that show called? When magical battles became commonplace or whatever. Yeah. When that guy just won't stop putting Norse mythology names on things, like a huge weeb. And then that girl's like, what are you doing? Like, stop it. You gotta dial it back, man.
Yeah, just take it down a notch. But yeah, as Theo's saying here, you know, it is Gendo kind of drops this information, I think, in the movie about how the different impacts will do different things. And you can also, if you wanted to, draw lines from this to how the world was made in Genesis. Originally, God created the earth on day one. He made the land on day two. He made the ocean on day three. He made the, you know, this kind of draws some parallels to that. But in reality, at least in my opinion, all of this is a lot of window dressing to make Gendo talk to his son. And that's the real point, is like, oh, okay, yes, we're going to, you know, create this kind of convoluted scenario to get Gendo and Shinji's consciousnesses to mesh so that they can finally have the talk that they should have had a long, long time ago and work out their problems. So this starts with Gendo realizing that he has, how would you put it? Man's got some issues, just like some issues.
I love that. I love
extremely
that.
General. Yeah,
what in the hell was going on here? Like, okay. I was just like, oh, Lord.
So he's not human anymore at this point, according to him. But I mean, that's debatable considering like the conversations that they end up having are very human conversations, right? So he's afraid of his son, because of course he's afraid of his son. He abandoned him after his mother died, let someone else raise him, has no idea how to confront him or have any of the big tough conversations, you know, when he was supposed to be the person who comforted his son when Yui died, which could have kind of been his fault because he let her partake in like weird experiments to begin with. But anyway, you know, when she died, it would have been on Gendo to comfort his son and to have the strength to tell him that, you know, your mom's dead and she's not coming back and it's just us now. But he's a coward. It's okay. A lot of people are. Like, that's like, you know, he's also dealing with his own grief.
That is life. Is peaceful. Yes.
Yes. He's dealing with his own grief. His wife is dead. He doesn't know how to handle it because she's the only, like, human he's ever wanted in his life.
He even says, like, I didn't want, like, a child. I don't like children. Like, he was like, you know what I mean? It's just...
He also admits that, like, his parents were probably pretty crappy. The only thing is that he was interested in... I mean, this is like maybe Lindsay's hot take. I have the impression that Gendo is definitely like a neurodivergent person who had really bad parents.
Yeah.
He like the way that he describes like himself and his feelings about people and, you know, just that he enjoys solitary time. All that stuff like has big autism spectrum messaging like all over it. That's not what made him a bad dad. I want to like say that very, very strongly. Like Gendo being that way isn't why he was a bad parent. He was a bad parent because he was scared and he ran away, just like how his son has been doing for a lot of the show. Shinji's been trying not to run away from the pain of interacting with others, but his dad did. He ran away from his son because it was too painful to confront him.
He also liked
what happened.
Yeah, he also liked control. Like, he was talking about how he loved playing the piano because it always did what it was supposed to. You know what I mean? And, like, I think he said he had another comparison. And that's something else that, like, I ain't gonna lie, I was crying like a little B-word when this scene with Gendo was going down. Because it's just, like, he seems so strong and so put together and like he has his
don't
plan.
Do it. I can't do it.
I know. Yeah. I'm like, why would you put that up? You're literally going to make everybody cry right now. And then it was like, you just saw how weak he was and that he was like afraid and that he why are you doing that right now? I'm like literally gonna cry. And it's just like,
it's good, it's really good.
I think it's like very interesting because I think that there are two types of people in this world, and there are people who are reckless and aren't afraid to get hurt, and they just keep on getting hurt and hurt and hurt. You know what I mean? And but mm-hmm. then that causes
Misato's like that.
Misato, right?
Because she can't break herself off from Kaji, and he's hurting her because he can't give her the like emotional sincerity and closeness that she's looking for.
Yes, anyway, continue. Exactly. Love her.
Yeah.
Even though that's a total weakness, but she's just a mirror me. So I was like, yes, totally true. but then it's like. With, I think what has always been very interesting about Gendo is that he's like so put together and so like, you know, just a man of mystery, right? And then we saw this and it was suddenly like, holy, everything makes sense. You know what I mean? You're just like, he is just as sad as his son. He is like a parallel of his son. You know what I mean? Lindsay, you're like, literally, I'm on the brink of tears.
Because I'm sorry. Like, this part was so, this part was like so hard because you know that he's confronting his, how much he screwed up, how bad, yes. You know, how bad he has been
the
as a father.
The craziest thing. And he's thinking, yeah, sorry.
This is like kind of the equivalent of saying like, I'm going to go to hell versus going to heaven. I'm not going to get to see my, you know, I'm not going to get to be reunited with the woman I love because I look what I've done. You know, he's feeling guilt so bad at this point that he's thinking that, you know, he doesn't get to be reunited with his wife.
Well, I thought the crazy, like, so that, but then yeah. Also like there's one line where he's like, I was looking for Yui, like all over, and like Yui was in you, like the whole time.
As a parent, like when that yeah. happened, like I admit, like initially, I was like, "Duh, you idiot! Your yeah. kids are, you know, your kids are the in the most ideal circumstances, your kids are the result of the love you have with your partner, and they're the, you know, they're basically the physical representation of that." You know, that doesn't work out for everyone, obviously. But in this case, that's what Shinji was for Gendo and Yui. And so for him to be like, oh, Yui was always in you. I'm like, yes, you idiot.
Can I share my take on why we have this almost unbearable lore dump right before we get this ridiculously cathartic emotional ending for Gendo?
Mm-hmm.
So one of the key themes of this movie really in particular, but it comes up a little bit in the original series too, is the show forcing the viewer to confront the fact that it's just a story, right? That's like the mm-hmm. metafictional angle. In the original series, you have that sequence where, you know, it shows you the anime that it could have been. And this is, you know, in the Evangelion film, it does that thing where it shows the shots of live action real world Japan.
Right.
To really just remind you that you are watching like a work of fiction. And this is a, you know, this is not something that exists on our, you know, our plane. And then for years and years and years, right, there was this pet theory among fans because of some lines from Karu, because of some of the imagery from throughout the first few movies. That that the rebuild movies weren't a remake, but a sequel, right. Where you have a continuation of the events and the storylines from the original. And something that I realized watching Gendo's arc in this movie, and something that I think makes the complete nonsense lore stuff make a lot of sense, is that there is even a couple of lines where, you know, it mentions that Ritsuko has suspected the existence of the imaginary Evangelion, and it like she theorized about it as well. And then she had that line where when she shoots Gendo like a bunch, yeah. She has a line where she says, you know, like you taught me to shoot first, like, and not hesitate. And my first thought was like, no, he didn't. That never happened in this universe. That never occurred at all. This is referencing a scene that doesn't actually exist for anyone that hasn't seen the original movie.
Right.
But then when we get to the end of the film and you have Shinji confront his father, actualize that kind of final part of his relationship where he needed to really come to terms with who his father was and the flawed and kind of abusive guy that he was in Shinji's life. Shinji has that moment where he realizes, you know, I have to reject Evangelion kind of completely. And not to get too far ahead, but for Gendo, it's almost, to me, it feels like maybe he had that same realization that there is like, that Eva is fictional. This is a story that repeats. This is something that has happened dozens and dozens and dozens and if not hundreds of times. Some people like Kaoru can even remember it. And maybe Gendo like figured it out. But instead of confronting the fact that he's living in like a fictional simulacrum and in a fake world, a fantasy filled with robots and angels and stuff, he doubles down because he can't confront what he's done to his son, and he can't confront the fact that he doesn't have his wife. And what I realized is all of the nonsense that like gets overloaded in Eva 3 and 4 is basically what would happen if Hideaki Anno, I mean, he did. He just kept making Eva for 15 more years. Mm-hmm. And what happens? You get dozens and dozens of nonsensical Eva variations, and you get all of these different lore drops, and you get impact after impact after impact. And Gendo is kind of, he's basically doing what the movie is kind of warning you not to do, where he is losing himself in the fiction of Evangelion, and he's trying, he's convinced that, oh, if I just repeat this story again, if I just watch these same story beats and do these same robot battles, I'll finally get what I want. I'll finally get to be with my wife or whatever. And so he's what Shinji could have been if he just got trapped in that cycle for all of eternity, just living out the story of Evangelion over and over. And so not only is it this ridiculously powerful personal moment where Gendo the character has to really reckon with what he's done to his son, but it's also kind of the big moment in the movie where Anno, the creator, is kind of saying, this is where we have to let go of Evangelion and everything that came before it, because that we can't move forward.
Gendo will make me cry right now.
Gendo will never be able to hug his son if Eva just keeps happening over and over again. We have to break it once and for all. And if breaking it means dumping 55 Eva units and 5 impacts on the characters until the story shatters, then fine.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, you kind of see him take like, another part of the metafictional angle, you can kind of see it in this picture here, is that when before Shinji and Gendo have like truly connect and start talking, they're playing through, and it's a lot like taking two action figures and smashing them against each other. They're playing through these scenes from the TV series and the end of Eva movie. They're revisiting the sets, like literally in a sense. Like we see, whoops, where is it? I'm sorry. I have so many images. Anyway, there's like, yeah.
That's actual footage of my condo. Just
we see them fight in this kind of awkward looking CG battle at first, and then
I hated that, by the way.
It was intentional.
I like, knew, it looked but bad it was on so purpose bad.
Because they like
it was a big Ultraman fight.
Yes, and then you see that like the backdrop sky is just a backdrop. It's not really the sky. It's not real. And then we see we see them in Misato's apartment, and we also see them trying to remember like one of the other spots that they show. Oh, we see the piano, and like Shinji's head's all sideways, like Ray's from the end of Eva. Like they start doing all these visual references to the past. Now it depends on, you can interpret, I feel, this different ways. I kind of am under the impression that there was actual looping involved. So you're kind of seeing all the past endings, the once, the twice, and now we're at the thrice upon a time ending. Where things didn't work, and how they've just been sort of repeating this over and over again. People in the chat have mentioned that Kaoru seems to be actually aware of the looping, because there's this weird shot on the moon with all of his coffins and stuff, and him waking up over and over and over again.
He has that line where he says the only thing that will kill him is like, it's not even, what is it? It's not like the heat death of the universe, but it's like, a complete like vacuum erasure of all existence. Like he can't die. He can't. Yeah. He can't stop existing.
So he and Gendo have, so when Shinji and Gendo finally, you know, have that big moment, Gendo also gets what he wants, and he's able to reunite with Yui, because their spirit or soul is still inside that Evangelion unit. Shinji is prepared to sacrifice himself, but this time it's from a place of like responsibility and kind of like adulthood, as like adult responsibility, because he wants to protect the people important to him now, instead of it feeling like he's being forced into this by the adults around him or the expectations of others.
And not just caring about himself. Like, yeah. I think in all of the past endings, it's always been, you know, just so focused on him and his perspective, and whether it was 25 and 26 where, you know, he was had his come to Jesus, or end of Evangelion where he's, well, I don't need to go on, but yeah, no, it was really nice. Yeah.
Yeah. When Shinji meets Asuka on that beach.
I'm about to get to that. I have an image for that.
I can't wait.
Okay. But so he's going to sacrifice himself and remove Evangelions from the world. He's like, I'm taking Eva out. Eva is done. And this does work, like James was saying, on like a metafictional. It's like Anno saying, like, Eva's done. Now there's no more Eva. You'll have to do something else. You can't keep doing this anymore. And so he's going to sacrifice himself to do that. But Gendo and Yui do it instead. So as his parents, they sacrifice themselves for their son in like one of the first like pure acts of parental love on Gendo's part, and Shinji is able to rescue Asuka. And so we return to end of Evangelion in imagery wise and I think feel like also kind of timeline wise and we get this really beautiful very beautiful image of
Theo said, and then Gendo finally gets to spoon Yui.
Yeah, Gendo finally gets to
spell. Oh, my God.
So Asuka wakes up. I can tell this was animated like by someone in particular because the style of the scene is very different than the rest of the movie.
Yeah.
So she wakes up on the beach like she usually does, but Shinji's not on top of her strangling her this time, you know? He's just... and she's grown up, which is, I mean, yeah, the like imagery is a little bit like woo, woo, but... for lack of a better term, but she's like outgrown her plug suit. She's not 14 anymore. She finally has an adult body, and she has also kind of, you can tell she's a little embarrassed actually for like him to see her in that way, even though she had been so forward about like, look at me, I'm a grown up, look at my body, isn't it like sexually enticing? You know, don't you want to have like an adult relationship with me? But now that she's finally an adult, she's like, hey, you know, like she's a little more shy about it. And, oh God, this scene kills me, actually.
I know, I like have, my eyes are watering and I'm not saying a word.
Oh, because...
Well, it's like the first time that Shinji is at a place where he's, even though now Asuka is like in her fully grown body, you know, we saw that she still in a lot of ways has the mentality of a kid.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, when he, I mean, the line that absolutely killed me was when he just says, I'm really happy I got to see you before the end. And I'm happy that I'm going to be able to, you know, I can give you a chance to be happy with someone else. And I was like, Shinji is the adult in this particular, like for the first yes. time, he's the adult that is telling her like, it's okay. Like everything's all right. You're going to be okay. Go be with Ken, your dad boyfriend or whatever that relationship dynamic is.
Oh my God.
Because there was a scene right before this where she's kind of talking about how she envied him because he, at least when both of his parents were alive, they doted over him. Right. And it's different in the manga. In the manga, Asuka's the product of in vitro fertilization with like a sperm donor. Like she doesn't actually have like a father in her life at all. But in the anime, she, you know, she had parents. I believe they divorced, or her mother dies very tragically, and it gives her a lot of baggage.
She committed suicide, right?
Yes, she killed herself. Yeah. But prior to that, she had a psychotic break from the experiments. Was always talking to this doll. The doll is recontextualized in the rebuild films as this puppet that Asuka actually talks to for comfort, instead of it being like something that she has a strong disgust towards, because that has elements of why her and Rei's relationship is so bad in the TV series, is because she sees a reflection of Rei as kind of doll-like in the same way. Yeah. So anyway, before this scene, the doll is really big, and she's like, she's thinking about, you know, the relationship she wished she could have had, or the parental love that she was lacking. And then Kensuke is revealed to be the one inside of the doll, and he basically, you know, tells her, you know, like he comforts her in that sense. And then she wakes up and Shinji's here on the beach with her, and then they, you know, have their kind of heart to heart, and he tells her goodbye, and it feels sort of like, again, like a parting, a growth, you know, growing apart sort of thing, like we're both adults now. One thing about this screenshot that I think is kind of important is you'll notice that her Ava hair things are not on her head in this scene. Mm-hmm. And throughout the entire television series, even when she wasn't a pilot, she always wore them. It was sort of like a sense of identity for her, because she only felt like she had value so long as she was capable of piloting an Ava. In this scene, they're not on her head. And I feel like that's indicative of her like having a new sense of self separate from Evangelion, because we are saying goodbye to all of Evangelion. So yeah. Shinji says goodbye to Asuka here. And I cried and cried.
Dude, Asuka's... So I liked Asuka, but I was definitely... I think I vibe more with Masato, because Asuka was just extremely selfish. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, it was like Masato... I don't think Masato is selfish. I think Masato is reckless, and she puts everyone before herself, and that's why she treats herself like shit, and her, excuse my French, sorry, why she, her place looks like hell, and she doesn't eat food unless it's microwave, because she just doesn't have respect for herself or care for herself. So
she's got, like, a complex with her dad, too.
Yes, as well. Yes, like definitely.
Yeah.
Let's not even go there. but, like, so for Asuka, like, I liked her because she was fiery, but I was always like, God, she's so selfish. And it was hard for me to vibe with her. And then when this movie came out and we saw that she was like, I just want someone to see me. I just want someone to, like, tell me I'm, like, doing well. Like, it was just like, oh, my God. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it hit me, like, so hard. I felt like they really did her justice. Like, I felt like... So I'll be completely honest. Like, I loved the anime series, hated End of Evangelion, but I always felt like everybody was kind of left with their story not completed, or just no one really got justice, right? Or like, it was just, something was just missing always. And the tetralogy, without a doubt, is a little like saccharine, right? Like, very different than End of Evangelion, and which was, I was like, okay, is he going to go dark or heavy? And this was like very hopeful, but like, I felt like he really made, he gave closure. That's the word. Yeah. He really gave everyone closure. You know, it was like Rey being able to find her, you know, there was multiple Rays, but the Ray going through all the hard work and like meeting those women and like finding herself was like, Ray has an identity. She's not just a clone. Like, she's doing things on her own. And that made me love Ray. You know what I mean? It made me love Ray. And this, yeah. And like, long haired Ray looking like a baddie. And I don't even,
they don't really comment on it, but she's got like a Gendo doll too there. That she's,
is
like,
it? I thought it was, yeah, a baby. It was a Gendo doll. Oh my god.
Because I feel like, as like a clone of Yui,
yes,
Rei kind of was cloned specifically to care for Shinji. So she's kind of got this predisposition, I think, to be kind of a maternal figure in general, right?
Agreed.
So,
well, they made that explicit in this one where Asuka even says, like, no, we were like literally programmed to feel certain ways about Shinji.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, we were that designed. Was
creepy, but yeah, funny.
It's, I mean, Anno commenting on the way that fans have sort of taken these characters over the years, when the women in Shinji's life literally have to confront the fact that they were designed based off of their relationship with Shinji, that they had
That's so meta. Yeah. It's so meta, because it's basically like saying, like, it's like Anno telling the audience, like, these characters are waifus. That's why they were made, was to be potential romantic interests for him. And actually, that's awful to do to a person. Like,
but you know what I liked about that?
Is to, like, yeah.
But Asuka's, but this is, that's one thing that happens to us in life, is that trauma impacts us and forces us to act certain ways, right? But when we find out about that trauma, we gain some sort of control. You know, so what I liked when Asuka was like to Rey, she's like, you know, oh, I care. She's like, oh yeah, we're all supposed to be like that. And like, she can at least, like, Asuka could reprogram herself.
Subvert it.
She had that knowledge. Exactly. You know, which I thought was like, again, we were talking about like hope and everything like that. Like, I that was probably a line people overlooked easily, but actually meant a lot to me, because I was like, Asuka is so self-aware now. You know what I mean? Even though she still had like all this to figure out, but it was like, I don't know, Asuka, I liked Asuka in the tetralogy, and I did not like Asuka in the anime. Like, I don't know how you guys feel about Asuka, but like for me, I did not like her in the anime. In the tetralogy, I loved her. Like, you know what I mean? She was like banging on the glass and ready to kick his ass when he came back. And like, I was just like, I love that she still was like fiery and angry, but then she also had, and then, but was and playing her video games, but then had these moments where she was like shoving food down his throat and was like, get it together. Cause like, I'm sick of your, and then like the moment where she was like, yeah, we're all programmed to be like that, but I'm not going to let that control me anymore. I just, it was, and her trauma scene where she literally was like talking about like how she just wanted to be seen and wanted, like, she didn't care that like the Evangelion was her identity as long as it like someone would tell her like good job or approve of her. Like, it was just like, I like this is, and that I kind of got off it, but like it was just like we got closure. Like, this ended the way I wanted it to end for Rey. It ended like, I wouldn't wish she would have lived, you know, and didn't go, but like, you know, like there was, it was just like, they had so much more closure. The only character that I kind of was sad about was, I felt like Misato lost so much of herself. And I kind of talked to Lynzee about this before, was like, but in ways I do feel like, so I vibe with Misato like super hard, and I've like said this repeatedly. And like one thing that, and like this is not, again, new to anybody who watches A&M, but like I go through a lot of therapy and I've been doing a lot of self-work. And like one of the biggest things that like my therapist said to me was like, you need to stop looking for your parent in people. Like, you need to be your own parent. Like, you need to stop like looking for someone to rescue you. And like Misato was looking for people to rescue her. She was looking for Kaji to rescue her. And you know, like you could go on and on, you know.
But then she became a parent as well. And I have mixed feelings about that a little bit. You kind of see her, you know,
I want to hear your thoughts on this.
Yeah, I feel like me and James might be vibing a bit on this. So like it's said that she's pregnant with Kaji's child back when the third impact happens, right? And so when we come to in this one, her son, who she's also named after her now, you know, dead husband, is he's like a teenager. He's like 14 or 15 years old, and he's, you know, also doing volunteer work or whatever. And there's a photo that's taken with him and Shinji. And I feel like that relationship is supposed to kind of have a little more weight. Like, the movie wants us to give more weight to that relationship than I feel like is necessarily earned. I don't know that I got a lot of maternal feelings from Misato throughout this film, even though she was supposed to have them. The whole, like, I mean, I liked the part where they showed that they had that big, like, seed depository, which really, something like that really exists in, like, Iceland. I think they've got, like, all the seeds
that's awesome
in there just in case something bad happens. So it was kind of a version of that, but they show the watermelons, right? Which was always like Kaji's thing, is that he had this watermelon garden that he was just hanging out in. I felt like, and I know this film went through some script rewrites, so that might have something to do with it as well, but I felt like that was maybe one of the weaker points, was the Misato mother angle. Like,
and like, she would have wanted to be a good parent after her dad was such a shit one. Like, that pissed me off.
And that she kind of left him on Earth and other people were raising him in a lot of the same
and
way.
And she
that
was like, oh, I'm going to just, but I care about villain, I'm not a good mom and stuff like that. I was like, fuck off. Excuse my French. But
it was very Gendo-esque, actually. Yeah. Like, not as dark, but there were some, like, I felt like there was some imagery there that
but
was
so not like similar. Misato, because Misato cared for Asuka and Shinji and Rei like they were her kids.
Yeah.
So it's like, why would her own kids she be like that? But then again, maybe you thought it was mirroring Gendo and she was afraid to get close to her own child because who knows? But then she claims all this ownership over Shinji when Shinji's there and then cuts him off. Like, Misato was a conflict for me because there was just too much inaccuracies with who I had fallen in love with, you know? So,
well, what's so weird about these movies, and I was reading a lot of behind the scenes info in prep for this episode, and something that kept coming up over and over is how improvisational Hideaki Anno can be as a creator.
Yeah.
You know, he takes a lot of ideas from his other writers and producers and even the voice actors playing the characters who will pitch things. He kind of writes as he goes. It doesn't seem like he really does a lot of planning ahead of time. Mm-hmm. And it's I think some of the weakest and I think most confusing parts of this movie are directly tied to how it has to sort of scramble to either explain or kind of retroactively reframe stuff that we didn't see in 3.0 specifically. Like if Ryoji Jr. had been mentioned in, or even shown in 3, and we understood that this new Misato had been so hardened and so consumed by her anti-nerve war that she, you know, become exactly the kind of parent she never wanted to be. That might have, there might have been something to that if we'd had time and, you know, the story had really unpacked it. Agreed, but the movie does this weird thing where in 3, she's totally trying to shove Shinji away. She's trying to distance and kind of disassociate as the maternal figure that she was trying to be. And that doesn't get resolved in the 3rd movie. And then in the 4th movie, you get introduced to Ryoji Jr. And then by the time Shinji's back on the Wunder, it's basically like Masato's over it, or like their relationship is kind of immediately forced back to closer to where it was. Yeah. And I don't know if Ryoji Jr. is there to kind of justify or to like emotionally kind of justify why Misato would suddenly be acting maternal towards Shinji again, even though the whole thing in 3 was that she wasn't doing that anymore. And yeah, it does feel like that. It feels to me like they had maybe an idea of what they wanted to do in 3, but then it just got scrapped and they said, and I mean, her sacrifice, right? Her sacrifice is, I mean, it's important because it's what gets Shinji the third spear that lets him do the end. Yeah. But it sucks that like the big emotional payoff to her 4 movie arc happens immediately before the story gets undone. And so I feel like it kind of does a little disservice to Misato in that way, where she doesn't get her chance. Like she doesn't get a goodbye with Shinji in the same way that Rei and Asuka and even Kaoru do.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know what the thought process was behind that, really.
Well, some people are making comments like, you know, oh, well, you know, she was trying to protect her son and like she's literally fighting to preserve the world so he can actually live.
I feel like it's okay that she sent him to live somewhere else. It's just like, I didn't really get the emotional honesty about
her. Yeah, what was her connect? Yeah, it was like, exactly. Like, it's like, Lynzee, and I don't want to even put you in that mindset, but just think as a parent, like if you really wanted to protect your child and you really, things were really bad and you had to send them away and you had to, right?
Right.
But it just didn't seem like it. It would fucking
kill me, man. Like, it was like,
where was her pain? Where was her sorrow? And that,
I felt like we needed a quiet moment of her, like, having a small breakdown or
exactly,
something with no one else there, because she's putting on this strong face for everybody else because she has to, you know.
And she was such an emotional character always, and she was so emotionless in the 4th movie to me. It was just like she was always playful or angry or, you know, like so emotional. Yeah. And it was like, and part of me, I could see it was almost like she had been so hardened and she had lost that Misato. Like that Misato had died. You know what I mean? And it was like now this like heartless commander, you know what I mean? But it just made me sad because it was just like, you know, we love Misato for being just so reckless in everything that she did, and so for her to like kind of lose that like emotional recklessness, like kind of just it gutted me. And I actually thought Ritsuko, who like I always liked, and I felt like they effed her so bad in the series and the movies, they always just made this like strong, intelligent woman just be so weak in the end. They did her justice in the tetralogy.
I liked how she went out in the end of this as well.
Loved it compared
to the past. There's one more character that I think we might want to get to before we wrap things up.
Yeah.
And we haven't really talked about her at all. And I feel like she might be the most meta character here.
Sakura Suzuhara, younger sister of Toji.
Mari. Mari's like perfect girl. She's just like best girl, huh?
So I have a lot of questions about her, James. I don't know if your deep dives have revealed anything as far as like, because
they have and they haven't.
Okay. So one thing that I can say for sure, and you've seen it in the other images leading up to this point, Mari has definitely existed in some way or form for a very long time. She was present at Shinji's birth. Fuyutsuki refers to her as Mary Iskarot for reasons that aren't really like explained at all.
Yeah.
And she also, I think, is, you know, older and not growing for maybe the same reasons that Asuka and whatnot is.
She might also be a clone if the naming convention. So a lot of people have said that her last name being Shikanami makes it seem like she's a series pilot in the same way that Rei and Asuka are.
Which would make sense with her appearing, you know, during Shinji's birth and whatnot. But possibly having the same memories as that. Well, I hope not. Okay, so I have a lot of complicated feelings about this because, yeah, first of all, you know, they never really, throughout the entire rebuild, it seemed like they couldn't really figure out what to do with Mari. My personal opinion is that she is a Miyoko Ano insert character and is representative of Ano's wife in a lot of ways.
I think yes and no. I did see, and I don't know when this went out. I don't know if it was specifically for 4 or if it was more for 3. I know that there are a lot of people in Japan who have, you know, come to that conclusion, and I think it's a very obvious conclusion to come to. I think
what's her relationship with Asuka? Because I'm very confused.
They are Kaoru and Shinji vibes, but just as girls.
Yeah,
100. Like, yeah. I was, yeah, like, are they together? There was a few moments where I was like, are they together?
Right.
Are they,
right,
like, even right, their banter on the, I was gonna say the court or the field, because like my volleyball brain thinks that, but even in the battlefield, like it was a little romantic, and I was like,
oh, they were flirting.
Oh, they're flirting. They're definitely flirting. Yeah. I also think Mari kind of flirts with everybody, though.
That's also true. Yeah.
Yeah. I think she definitely just likes to get attention and just flirt with everybody and talk about her big boobs a lot. So,
yeah.
But I did read that, I guess, in Japan, enough people were making the same observation that we made, where it's like, oh, the way the story ends and the way that Shinji is so obviously Ano's avatar in this story, and the same with all the characters are to a degree, then obviously Mari is the Moyoko Ano figure, right?
Yeah.
I guess Moyoko Ano herself like had to come out and kind of say, I am not her. That is not me. Like, okay, I don't want you to compare me to her. But I do think that she, at least Mari, represents the idea of Moyoko, in that she is the person that can come into your life that isn't a part of the narrative that you've been repeating for however many years. The person that can show you the person you can be and maybe bring you out of that and show you a way to a happier, brighter future. Just so I totally agree with you in that respect,
Escaping the site, you know, the same maybe toxic people you've been hanging out with, you know, you can branch out of where you've been in your life, try something new, meet someone new, and that person, yeah, can make all the difference for you as someone to support you. Mm-hmm. Because in the end of Evangelion, well, I mean,
the for realsies end.
For the end of Evangelion, Shinji gets to grow up too, and so does Mari, and they live happily ever after. At least that's how I interpreted the
end.
Yeah,
that's how I interpreted too. Yeah.
Universe is Evangelions are removed from the universe. We see this train station. Train stations have appeared repeatedly throughout Evangelion as sort of a space of like contemplation or changing, you know. Just change and reflection. When Gendo was reflecting on his life, he was at a train station he was on a train. And in the past, when Shinji would get into himself, he would also be on a train. And notably, when Gendo and Shinji meet and hug, Gendo has stepped off of the train and they're at the train station holding each other. And then we see that sort of imagery return here. When the universe is redone, Evangelions are removed, animals and life is back to how it should be in their absence. Everyone is at, you know, on the other side, on a different, boarding a different train is Kaoru and Rei.
Asuka's there too.
Asuka is there too. I missed her when I first watched the movie. I didn't see
She's
her.
Super tiny. They don't focus on her. She's like, I missed her the first time too. But yeah, she's right also, there in the corner.
Yeah. And then, you know, Shinji's sitting there. He's still wearing the choker, but Mari's the one she takes it off of him. They flirt a little bit, and then he takes her hand, and they run off together out of the train station and into Anna's hometown.
and the greatest Utada Hikaru needle drop in the history of Utada Hikaru needle drops takes us to the credits.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is, what is it? Beautiful Boy is the name of the song, you think?
No, One Last Kiss.
Oh, One Last Kiss, right. Which I was told, I have no idea if this will work, but I was told that if I, no.
And again, I know that we're not like supposed to directly, and maybe Morioka's statement was made more as like a general, like, don't like send me weird Mari memes or anything.
Right. Yeah.
But like, come on. This super hot, gorgeous, artistic brunette, which really like kind of hit me right in the chest because my wife is an incredibly beautiful, gorgeous, long-haired brunette that did the same thing for me in my life and helped me find a happy and good future.
Oh, you're gonna make me cry.
And the song literally just says, I love you more than you could ever know. And it's just like, come on, Anno, you fucking wife guy of the century.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Mad respect.
Yeah, the song.
No, Lynzee, you said you wouldn't do this. No.
I don't think I actually said I wouldn't do
it.
I can't hear it. Is it playing?
It is.
I can hear it in my heart.
We can't hear it.
Oh, I didn't know if it would work. I've never tried to share YouTube on here before, so looks like you guys get to not cry.
I mean, I'm honestly, but I thought I would try. I'm not far from it. I'm like pretty close.
Yeah,
I'm really, I've like watered up like 5 times. So
I know.
Yeah.
I know. Yeah. So I feel like overall, I mean, there are elements of the films that I would call flawed, like, you know, and maybe if I were to go rewatch all of the, Jacki rewatched all of them like back to back. Mm-hmm. So
you're probably, how was that, by the way? Were you like
fun? Super fun. It was actually, it was actually really fun. Like the first one was just a redo of the anime series, essentially. The second one, it was in, but prettier, right? Yeah. Though I'll be honest, like it was cool to see it redone, but I just got something for 90s anime, even though it's like blocky and like, you know what I mean? And there's like, it's just not as smooth and stuff like that. I was kind of like, oh, I miss like the 90s feel of the original, you know? But it was cool. And then, seeing like, his changes, I really felt like this was him doing the story right, with the exception of Masato, but it was like, I liked that he actually had Asuka being the one in the third angel, and like that gave a lot, I mean, there was weight with it when it was Toji, right, is his friend's name? Yeah, yes. But it was, when it was Asuka, I think I was like, oh, this made this a lot heavier, you know what I mean? And so like, I liked the little changes he made. It was very, very fun to watch, like, as one thing. Like, you know, it was fun. But for me, it was, like, 2, 3, and 4 were really fun to watch. Like, the first one was kind of like, I don't know about y'all, but, like, I used to watch Star Wars with my dad, like the whole thing. We would have a weekend where we would just be watching the whole Star Wars, like, me, my brother, my dad, and my little sister, you know? And so I was like, if God ever bestows a child on me, then I'm going to go be a master commander of a giant spaceship and like send him off on a farm. But just kidding.
Naturally.
But no, I was like, I literally remember watching this and thinking like, I want to watch this with like my kid. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I want to watch 1, 2, 3, and 4 with my kid. And the best part is like, I always thought, God, I would love to share Neon Genesis Evangelion with like my child, but it's got the weird sexual parts that I don't understand.
Watching End of Ava with your kid would be like,
oh my God. Yeah. But 1, 2, 3, and 4, you can totally watch. I really don't like, yes, there's some gory stuff, but it's like,
there's also some horny cameras, but there's never like,
there's fan service cameras, but it's not like him, you know what, to a passed out girl on a hospital bed, a 28-year-old kissing a 14-year-old, like lots. And I honestly, like those things made me not love Evangelion as much as I wanted to. So it being like this, it really made me fall in love with the series again. I wish Masato got a little bit more justice than she did, but I mean, I was still happy with her. It was like, she's a badass. She, you know, maybe she just became hardened by everything that happened to her. Like, I can understand why Anno went in that direction. But, like, overall, like, the closure for Rei and Asuka, and especially Shinji, because I don't know about y'all, but I've always hated Shinji. Like,
oh, really?
Yeah, like, okay. I just always thought he was just whiny. And just,
I didn't like him upon first viewing as a kid, because yes. I definitely related more with Asuka, so I could, and I even felt myself getting frustrated with him again in this new movie, where I was just like, God damn it, Shinji.
Yes.
But I feel like as an adult and someone who, you know, has more life experience, I definitely have more sympathy for him than I did on first viewing, for sure.
Well, I think then, you know, when we watched it when we were teenagers, and I don't know your relationships with your parents, but it was like, you know, it was kind of like, I hadn't addressed that stuff yet. So when he was like talking about that stuff, I was like, yeah, I guess I kind of feel that way. But anyway, I don't want to think about that right now because I'm 16, you know, but then it was like when I got older and I was like in my early 20s and watching, I was like, shit, well.
Someone give that boy a hug, please.
Yeah, and I kind of get why he needs a hug, and I need a hug. You know what I mean? And then it was like you said, now with more experience, we're like, okay. Like, and you know what the interesting thing is, too? Everyone's like, shut up, Shinji, and Gen the robot. And that was how we've treated trauma, is like, just shut up with your trauma and get in the robot. That's how we've treated, like, all of us have. And when in reality, it's like, hey, go get therapy, do some shadow work, do what you need to do, and then maybe you'll be ready. But let's make sure you're ready. But it's like, I'm sorry. That's actually a really good point on my part. I tapped myself on the head there. But yeah, it's like, I don't know. And that's what we said at the beginning, is what makes this whole series beautiful, is that it makes us address the darkness in ourselves, but then gives us hope. So,
and hopefully more empathy for others too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's really what, you know, and that it's worth risking. It's worth risking pain to make those connections with the people most important to you and to care for one another. So take care of yourselves, everyone. This has been End of Evangelion Explained.
So thank you, fun!
Thank you, Jacki and James, for sticking out with us. Thank you for everyone who's stuck with us for the last 2 hours. Oh my God, you guys are hardcore. Pat yourself on the back.
Oh my gosh, we didn't even talk about the opening song. Somebody just brought that up in the chat. They should have put Zanku Goku no Tenchi. Like, how is that not in the tetralogy at all?
If we start talking about songs, I'm going to go on this whole thing about Fly Me to the Moon.
Yeah, I know.
I've had a very beautiful close out there, Jacki.
I know. I'm sorry. Dang it. I should just stay quiet. I'm sorry.
Right. Anyway, I love all you guys. And check us out at animenewsnetwork.com. We've got James's great essay about Evangelion up there. I've got one up there about the catharsis of the apocalypse. And also, you're going to want to see Jacki and I will be here again on Monday to talk about the villains arc on the A&N after show that's starting. Jacki, you got to get caught up because we're going to get some cool villain stuff coming from My Hero Academia. So thank you again, everybody. And we'll see you next time.
Congratulations.
Yay. Oh, yeah. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Bye. There's a...